Good morning.
Good morning.
My name is Sean Hudgenwardle, and I will be your moderator for this morning's class. Welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school, and it is not a church. Neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim, and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity to this present day. This school was established as the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated in the state of California in 1958. Since then, we've established various branch schools throughout the United States and in various foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. In this school, we use the true, correct, and original name and title of the Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of our Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted with Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted with God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted with Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles, and they are not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are lords many and gods many. But we now know that each lord must have a name, and each god must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin languages have any letters or characters in their alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state He is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have this cloud drawn all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a superincorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without having flesh and blood. This shape and form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question that we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach according to the divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he instructed Moses to come atop of Mount Sinai, where he showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This tabernacle consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In this school, we show proof that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The 10 primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First is to help you find and know Yahweh our Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or so-called law of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained that there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Today, we will have a prayer by Dr. Eunice Reiser that will be followed by a selection of music. Our scripture lesson will be the 23rd chapter of Matthew, and that will be read by Dr. Nanette Ramirez.
Good morning, class. Let us bow our hearts and mind in a moment of prayer. Father Yahweh, you have allowed us once again to come together and to learn more about your purpose, pattern, and your plan. And we ask that you open up our hearts and mind and quiet our hearts and mind that we may receive what you are about to present to us. And we ask that you continue to take care of us during these times and keep our minds still while we learn and go through the things that we have to go through to learn more of your purpose, pattern, and plan in reality. All these things and many others we ask in thy son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say hallelujah. Thank you.
Hey! Good morning, class.
Good morning.
I'll be reading out of the Holy Name Bible containing the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Traina, the Scripture Research Association. I'll be reading Matthew, the 23rd chapter. Then spake Yahshua to the multitude and to his disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do, but do not ye after their works, for they say and do not. For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers, but all their works they do for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries and enlarge the borders of their garments, and love the uppermost rooms at feasts, and the chief seats in the synagogues, and greetings in the markets, and to be called of men, Rabbi, Rabbi. But be not ye called Rabbi, for one is your Rabbi, even the Messiah, and all ye are brethren. And call no man Abba, Father, upon the earth, for one is your Father, Abba, which is in heaven. Neither be ye called Master, for one is your Master, even the Messiah. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. And whosoever shall exalt himself shall be abased, and he that shall humble himself shall be exalted. But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. For ye neither go in yourselves, neither permit ye them that are entering to go in. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make a long prayer, therefore ye shall receive the greater damnation. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye compass sea and land to make one proselyte, and when he is made, ye make him twofold more the child of Gehenna than yourselves. Woe unto you, ye blind guides, which say, whosoever shall swear by the temple, it is nothing, but whosoever shall swear by the gold of the temple, he is a debtor. Ye fools and blind, for whether is greater, the gold or the temple that sacrificeth the gold? And whosoever shall swear by the altar, it is nothing, but whosoever sweareth by the gift that is upon it, he is guilty. Ye fools and blind, for whether is greater, the gift or the altar that sacrificeth the gift? Whoso therefore shall swear by the altar, sweareth by it and by all things thereon. And whoso shall swear by the temple, sweareth by it and by him that dwelleth therein. And he that shall swear by heaven sweareth by the throne of Yahweh, and by him that sitteth thereon. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithes of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law. Judgment, mercy, and truth, these ought ye have to have done, and not to leave the other undone. Ye blind guides, which strain at the gnat and swallow a camel. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye make clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Thou blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones, and are uncleanness. Even so, ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, because ye build the tombs of the prophets and garnish the sepulchres of the righteous, and say, if we had been in the days of our fathers, we would not have been partakers with them in the blood of the prophets. Wherefore ye be witnesses unto yourselves, that ye are the children of them which killed the prophets. Fill ye up, then, and the measure of your fathers. Ye serpents, ye generation of vipers, how can ye escape the condemnation of Gehenna? Wherefore, behold, I send unto you prophets, and wise men, and scribes, and some of them ye shall kill and crucify, and some of them shall ye scourge in your synagogues, and persecute them from city to city, that upon you may come all the righteous bloodshed upon the earth, from the blood of righteous Abel unto the blood of Zechariah, son of Jehoiada, whom ye slew between the temple and the altar. Verily I say unto you, all these things shall come upon this generation. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and ye would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. For I say unto you, ye shall not see me henceforth, till ye shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of Yahweh. I have read Matthew, the 23rd chapter. Let us all say, hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Reiser, and thank you, Dr. Ramirez. For our first speaker today, I would like to call on Dr. Eunice Reiser.
Good morning, class. Good morning. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here this morning. The scripture lesson, I go back and just reading it, and I remember that it was talking about, I do believe it was plate 28. And that was about talking about really the Pharisees and how they are, they were, you know, they want to be seen. They want to have notoriety, but yet they can have things for the people to do, but they dare not to do it themselves. And I'm just going to say that I'm just thankful that Yahweh has allowed me to be here and to understand, to know that that he is not a unity and not a trinity, but is a unity. And I was listening to a class this morning, so I'm going to yield the floor because there's a lot of things that there's a change. Something is happening with me, and I'm not going to try to explain it or to just go through the fake of it. So with that, I'm going to say thank you for allowing me to have this expression and to be here.
Thank you, Dr. Reiser. For our next speaker, I would like to call on Dr. Christopher Williams. Who is the president of the Ontario branch.
You can say all that. Nobody cares.
Good morning. What's happened? Oh, yeah, I looked it up too. Interesting. I haven't heard that word ever, and I'm like, all right. Jewish boxes. As always, it's a pleasure and honor to stand before the body of Yahshua Messiah in hopes to impart something onto the body of edification purposes. Yeah, we're not going to get into Matthew. Yeah, that was fun, but, you know, not what I'm into. Before I get started, does anyone have any questions about anything? Anything at all? No? Where's Kenway when you need her? Okay. I don't really have a topic, but in honor of this interesting weekend, I will do my best to, I'll do something. What's always good is always to start with Yahshua Messiah, because that's what we're here for. This has been an interesting year, to say the least. And more specifically, in the last month, I'd say probably the most interesting month I've had in a long time. I don't live publicly. Typically, what I post in social media is just what's happening in the moment, and I try not to get too personal because that's not for everyone. And frankly speaking, I don't know why people put their stuff out in the streets like that. I always marvel at who could just, my man did such and such. Oh, this girl did this to me, and, you know, whatever the case may be. I get it. People need some place to lay that somewhere. And I try to stay as positive as possible. I think when I first got into social media, I was kind of a jackwagon. But over the years, I've learned to keep my jackwagonness to myself. But what I will say is y'all are still working with me. And I think as we grow in the gospel or as a person, Yahweh will never not work with you and cause you to rise and fall. And we all have those moments. I can think over the years of how my life has been. I've been on top of the world, and I've been in the depths of hell. All in the same month. Sometimes in the same day. And that's by a purpose, because that's what Yahweh chooses to do. And with that being said, I guess I will get personal and then, you know, put it on the gospel and on the pattern and go from there. So, with that being said, this year has been a year of transition and transformation for me. If you didn't know, I'd been dealing with some family drama, in a sense, with my children, not them specifically, but with their mom. And without getting into too much detail, we've had a difference of opinion when it comes to parenting and whose approach is better versus whose isn't. She is that of the new millennium and likes to let people express their feelings, and accountability is subjective to the person that is issuing it. And basically lacking, because that's what happens in this society. This is the everyone gets a trophy society where, you know, we just want everyone to feel good about themselves, and we forget about what that means. It's a very very self-absorbed approach to dealing with people, and it lacks it lacks, I guess, intestinal fortitude, right? For people that don't really understand, like my kids, intestinal fortitude has something to do with being able to have grit. You're able to take things. You can suffer through some things and grow from that. Hey, it's good to see you. And that's what is lacking in this generation. You know, I employ a lot of young people, and, you know, everyone wants a job, everyone wants money at the end of the, you know, pay period, but nobody really wants to have work, you know, the best they can or the hardest they can to get that money. Everyone wants an easy, free ride. That's what this society is about these days. We want a free ride. And with y'all, there's nothing done for free. There is a sacrifice for everything you do, right? Name a time where the Israelites went through something and didn't have to give up something in turn. There ain't a time. And likewise with me, I've been able to get a lot of different things in this world. And I've lost a lot in tow. There's been a lot of penalties paid for some of the things that I've either done, won, or had given to me. There's always a price for everything. And given that my brand of parenting is about accountability, because that's how I was raised. If you know anything about Joe Williams, he was not slack in holding people accountable. I remember telling my children about this recently. I was big in football in high school. I was a pretty good star. To this day, no one has ever achieved what I've been able to achieve at my position at my high school. And we've had nothing but NFL-bound people come through my high school. It is a really good school for putting people into college. And the people that played my position have played in the NFL, and they still have not broken my record for yards and touchdowns in the year. Okay? That's nothing big. It's high school. No big deal. However, to me at that time, that's all I cared about. I didn't care about going to school. I didn't care about getting good grades. Even though I was really smart and I was really talented with my brain, I was lazy on purpose. I wasn't lazy because I was just born that way. I was lazy because it was what my dad wasn't, and it's what he didn't enjoy me to be. Like, my goal in life was to do things despite him, because that's what young kids do. We get in our heads that we're going to affect someone's behavior by our actions, not realizing that we're paying a price. And because of that, my dad had levied this condition on me. Since you don't want to do your homework, you don't want to get good grades, that's fine. Don't do it and see what happens next. That's all he said. Every week or every day, I had to turn in a progress report. Basically, I would have my list of classes, and my teacher would have to sign off and note, was Chris, you know, on time? Yes. Did Chris turn in his homework? Yes. If there was something of note, it could be put on there. And the teachers enjoyed this because they knew that the one kid that would either keep the class productive or unproductive was going to be controlled by this document. I hated it because it was a control over me, and I had to conduct myself in a certain way that I didn't want to. Because remember, my whole goal was to be spiteful of my father. Go figure. With that being said, on this particular week, I just felt like not doing something. I just decided to blow off an assignment. Didn't have anything to do with my actual grade. It was just whatever assignment. Kind of challenging my dad to see what's he going to do. Well, on this particular week, it was a week that we're supposed to play against one of the weakest teams in the league, but I had college scouts coming to see me. Well, they had written me letters. They had called me and said, hey, we're coming to see you play this week. Three different teams, three different schools. Scholarship in tow, and Chris decides to use this week to not do something. So what do you think Joe Williams did when he got that progress report? Guess who ain't playing football this Friday? I begged and pleaded. Listen, normally he'd slap me up, smack me down, and, you know, we go about our business. Nah, he didn't lay one finger on me. He just said, you're not playing. But you're going to practice every week, all day. Every day until the game. And you can stay on the sidelines. You can go to the game. But guess who ain't playing? Oh, yeah. Yeah, exactly. That's how I felt. And do you think that made my situation with him better or worse? I got even more spiteful. But you know what I didn't do anymore? I didn't miss any more assignments. Because Joe Williams wasn't slack with his promise about holding me accountable. And as a kid, I resented my father. I didn't hate him, but I resented him. I can remember every butt whooping I got. I can remember every time he yelled and told me about something about myself. I can remember to this day like it happened like last night. And at the time, I thought my dad just didn't like me. In fact, I didn't think he loved me very much over the years because he never said it. It was something he never did. I could think of two opportunities in his life that he said, "I love you." Just two. The first memory of him telling me he loved me was a Friday night. I was 9 years old after class. We're getting dressed, getting ready to go to bed. And he goes, "Chris, you know I love you, right?" I said, yeah, okay. He goes, "Okay, good." And then he just went to bed. I was like, man, that was weird. What's that? Another time, after class, I'd given a lecture, and then he gave a lecture like, no, I didn't give a lecture. He gave a lecture, and he said something like, he was talking about how being a parent was a burden. And as a kid, I hear that I'm a burden. I was so hurt. Like, what do you mean I'm a burden? I didn't understand what he was talking about because I was a kid. I was literally, I think, like 11 years old. It's like, oh, humbug. This guy, he thinks I'm a burden. Well, I'll show him. And I'm just pouting after class. Like, why are you pouting? Why are you acting like this? And listen, you don't pout in front of Joe Williams. I'm just dead serious. You got a problem? Ooh, you better fix that quick, right in a hurry, or you're gonna have a real problem. And I chose to use this heel to die on. And he's like, "What's your problem?" Before he's about to slap me upside the head. I said, "You just called me a burden. What do you mean by that? How am I a burden? I didn't ask to be here." He goes on to explain to me. He goes, "You aren't a burden, but the act of being a parent and having children is a burden. Here's what a burden is." And he goes on to explain to me, there's burdens are everything, but it's a choice we make out of love for you, because I love you, Chris. Number two. Now, if you've listened to anything I just said, none of this has to do with just people being people. It has everything to do with Yahweh in him, all right? Everything I've been through is about the purpose of planning Yahweh in effect. Everything. And mind you, this entire time, I'm thinking my dad don't care about me, don't love me for anything. Imagine how the Israelites feel when they're going through all this. Imagine being told, "You're going to have to stay in that wilderness for 40 years until you die off." That sounds like somebody just don't love you, right? Not realizing that the goal was to get into heaven in principle for these Israelites. I didn't realize how much my dad cared about me until I had my kids. And every day or some month during their lives, I was like, "Hey, Dad, yeah, I want to say I'm sorry, man. Yeah, remember that time I did such and such? Yeah, so-and-so did this right now. I understand now. My bad. Thank you." I did this for years. For years. Because my kids were reminding me of how much of a burden I was on my dad. Because we don't understand as we're going through things how much someone or something is for our growth, not for our detriment. So we go through things all the time. Someone lies to you. Someone tells you about you. Something happens where you get fired or you get demoted. Someone you think wants to be your friend tells you, "I don't really like you that much." You have all these things happening to you in your life, and you think it's about hurting you, but it's never about you. It's about the principle behind the situation. These 10 devastating plagues that happened down here, these Israelites thought, what the heck is happening down here? Not realizing that Yahweh was doing something, not just to them, but really to the Egyptians. He let them experience three of them so they understand that at any given moment, this can and will happen to you. But the other seven was experienced only by the Israelites, or by the Egyptians, because he wanted them to know, I got you. I got fired from my job I'd been at for 16 years. I live, breathe, and ate UPS. I miss activity, doctor's appointments, performances, baseball games, basketball games, special moments in my kid's life for this job, chasing what I thought was my dream. And mind you, as a kid, I never wanted to be a businessman. I didn't want to know anything about it. I thought people in business were just, you know, scoundrels. I didn't think anything nice about people in the business world. But here I am, chasing that same dream years later. And then I get fired from this job that I just loved. At UPS, in this area, I was a big deal. Not like it's stature-wise, because, I mean, I was just a middle manager like everybody else that was a middle manager. But when there was a job that needed to get done, they didn't just send anybody. They sent Chris. We want to, you know, improve our situation in this area. Smooth Chris over there. He'll figure it out. That's what they did. Hey, you struggling? Call Chris Williams. He'll tell you how to get it fixed. In fact, some people didn't even wait. They just called me. Hey, man. From San Diego to Vegas to Woodland Hills, wherever, people will call me, find out how am I doing it. And listen, I never bragged. Someone else bragged for me. I hated the attention. Because every time someone called me, it's like, yeah, what can I do for you? Because now I got to stop what I'm doing to go help you. That made my job that much harder. And even when I try to just do okay, everybody else did way worse. So I looked better than I really did. That's just the way it was. Go figure. I try to be in the middle of the pack. Because the middle of the pack, no one messes with the middle of the pack. If you on the bottom, everybody know your name. If you on the top, everybody knows your name. But if you in the middle, who are you? Siobhan? What? Nobody know who. Right? But that's just not the way Yahweh let me be. I was always in that top 10, top 5. It's like, don't let me be number one. Ah, dang it, I'm number one again. Right? It seems like, why would you feel that way? Because the reward for being the best is what? More work. That's all you got. And it's a thankless job for being the best, because if you fail, you get criticized. If you win, everyone expects you to win. So why be the best? Because it's who we are. We are innately, we always want to be the best. And if we don't, it's because there's something preventing us from being that. See, my dad never said, go out there, be the best person you can possibly be. He just said, as a black man in America, you have to be 10 times better than the average person. Because that's just how they see you. That's how they see us. So don't think for one second that you can just go in there and just be okay and they're going to give you anything. In fact, they're going to give you less because you're just okay. You have to be 10 times better than the guy who's really bad at his job just to be considered okay. And to be considered the best, you got to beat everybody. That's why I was number one. Because I didn't want anyone to fire me. Like every day I went to work thinking like, oh my gosh, they're going to take my job away from me if I don't do this. I could hit 99 things on the 100 list of things I got to do. But the one thing could be the most minute thing. Don't even have a cost associated with it. I'm the worst manager on the planet. That's how that was. And I lived and breathed for that job. The whole point I'm bringing up is, as much as I did for this dang on job, they fired me. I became a number. I was 1317,000. That's my ID number. Yeah, that's my ID number. To this day, I'm 1317,000. It stays with me forever. No one gets my number. That's the only good thing about that place. I get to take that with me. And because I was only 1317,000, they had no problem kicking me out. It didn't matter that the year before, I'd saved them $1.7 million. It didn't matter that the revenues that I brought in actually helped carry my entire district. I generated more packages from my little seat than 90% of my peers from my center. And they had no problem saying, bye-bye. But I knew about 10 people who had done egregious acts, and they put them on the street for a minute just to say, yeah, we did something to them, and then brought them back. 10. 5 before me and 5 after me. All of them white. And to me, I was so sad and depressed about that event. Why is this relevant? Because it was the best thing that ever happened to me. I had to learn a number of things. One, I wasn't squat. That person that I concocted in my head that I'm this, that, and the other, I'm the best thing on the planet, because I actually thought like that. Because that's just how I was bred within those ranks. The job creates that bravado. You have to be this way. I need to be humble like nobody's business. Didn't they go through a humbling experience? They had a fall. They got here. They curse Yahweh. Oh, why'd you bring us out here to die? They weren't grateful for anything. They weren't humble about anything, and so they all had to die off. The old me had to die off. I had zero compassion for people. Absolutely none. It didn't matter if it was my kids, my wife, my friends, people I didn't know, I had zero compassion. And then when I fell, all I wanted was just somebody to give me a little compassion. Just a little bit. Ain't that ironic? Right? I had to face the man in the mirror who was just an ugly person. Ugly person. And I spent the next 6 months facing that person every day. And it was like I was picking a scab that had healed itself every day until the scab went away. And only after I did all this work and all this other, you know, things to develop myself, I had to fall a little bit just again, just to make sure you understand that you ain't squat. Literally, 9 months after I got a job, I got fired. 9 months. Now, granted, it had nothing to really do with me. But I did have something to learn. See, I had made a decision that when I get into another position, I'm going to not be like I was before. Have some compassion, you know, treat people the way they want to be treated, and just try to be level-headed when it comes to this. And I found myself behaving similarly, not the same, but similarly to what I was before I fell the first time. And so Yahweh said, he's still this guy. He still thinks it's about him. So let's humble him one more time so he can get it. And so he did. And for 2 months, I was trying to figure out, what did I do wrong this time? And then I decided, forget being the boss. I want to be a worker bee. I don't want to be in charge of anything. I don't want to be in charge of anyone. Just give me a job. I'll push a basket. I'll break rocks. Whatever you got for me, I'll take it. I tried to get a job lower than my abilities. I tried. No one would hire me. Starbucks wouldn't hire me. Del Taco refused me. Can you believe this? Del Taco. They said, nope. You know how sometimes they give you an email saying, sorry, but we decided to go another way. They told me no. Everybody for a month and a half said, nope. And then this unlikely of company called me and said, hey, want to interview? Meet here in Ontario Airport. Ontario, oh, this is great. I love local. I've been commuting for the last 10 years to L.A. and Cerritos and, you know, Baldwin Park. It was Pitts. But I said, Ontario, I can get with that. I got a job at Ontario Airport right around the corner. Best job of my life. Paid me half of what I used to make. I didn't even care about the money. I just said, be more than this, and I can survive. They gave me maybe $7,000 more than what I was expecting. And listen, I hadn't made that kind of money since I was like a driver at UPS. And I was happy. I mean, happy. Best job of my life. I didn't own anything, and I didn't have to report to anyone but one person. And he was never around. Best job ever. It was kind of like when they got over here and start feeling themselves. And all of a sudden, I saw the writing on the wall. I'm like, this job ain't really a job. I'm literally a messenger for this company to this company. My days are numbered. Yahweh gave me enough sense to know you better not put all your eggs in this basket. And so he said, hey, let me open up a different door for you. And so he did. Best door I ever walked through. Now I get to see my kids perform, do things. And if I choose not to, it's because I literally had to do something else that was more important than what they had going on. But something else I learned along the way. They can't be everything I do. Because that's not life. A lot of parents think that, oh, my kids, I gotta make sure I gotta do it for them. No. No. This is Mother's Day, right? Do you know how many moms I know that don't live their life because they want to make sure their kids are happy? But they're miserable. Miserable people. They don't like who they are. They don't like their life. They don't know. They don't go anywhere. They don't date. They don't build themselves up because they're worried about what their kids are doing. And listen, when they get to a certain age, they're going to leave and ain't going to even look back and say, hey, I hope you're good. Just being honest with you. I got four brothers. Half of one, besides me, takes care of my mom. And when I say half, that's only when that person gets money from me. Then they give it to my mom. Dead serious. But that's how it is. Rarely do kids still take care of their parents and make sure they're good. No, that's not what kids do. They run off, they get wives, they have lives, and they forget all about y'all. Moms. Dead serious. So, I never encourage a mom to all be out their kids. Kids this, kids that, no. Listen, Yahweh had enough sense to create a creation, put people in it, and give them guidance. But at the same time, he held them accountable and said, listen, this is how I need you to live, the way I see fit, not the way you see fit. And people, they struggled. The Israelites struggled to do this. Struggled like crazy. They didn't know what to do. And here we are. Looking at a gospel that confounds everybody. And it's simple. It's a very simple gospel when you have the tools and the keys to unlock it. I have a direction. Romans 1:19 and 20. John 1:1, and we'll go from there. Oh, and somebody gave me 1 John 5:7 and 8.
Romans 1:19.
Read.
because that which may be known of Yahweh.
Now, this is Paul talking to the Romans saying, hey, Yahweh's not just some person that you can't know. You can know who your creator is. You may not be able to see him with your natural physical eyes, because listen, nobody can see spirit. You can only see the manifestation of it. Let me prove that. Read.
Is manifest in them.
Mm-hmm.
For Yahweh hath showed it unto them.
Read.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Now, the invisible things of him, which is spirit, or universal spirit law, which is Yahweh himself, you can see the manifestation of him through his creation. Yahweh is threefold. We have an earth that is a crest, a core, and a mantle. One earth, but threefold. We speak past, present, and future. One language. That same principle resonates in every language on the planet. There's no other way any language or any person speaks other than past, present, and future. We have states of matter. There's only three. But yet, one matter, one principle of matter. An atom is nothing more than a proton, a neutron, an electron, one atom. It has variations that have that core principle. But when you break it down, that's all there is. There's either going to be a proton, a neutron, an electron. And Yahweh goes so far as to make the master atom or element, which is what? The hydrogen atom, right? It's the one that fathers them all. It has an electron and a proton. A neutron and electron. Where's the proton? Which one is it? Proton and neutron.
Proton and electron.
Excuse me? Proton and electron. No neutron. Now, the reason why this is so is to show that Yahweh is Elohim and Yahshua in part, but always one Yahweh, the invisible one, the one you can't see in visions and dreams. It's a reflection of the unity of the Spirit. That's what the hydrogen atom is. Continue in Romans, then we'll get John. First John.
Being understood by the things that are made.
Read.
Even his eternal power and supernal nature.
Now, his eternal power is what?
Power of transmutation.
The power to transform and take on shape of anything he chooses. Yahweh so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, so that whoever is to believe on him should not perish but have everlasting life. So he transformed into his only begotten son, Yahweh Elohim, which is the creation in bodily form. This is both the angelic and physical creation in one embodiment. And thus, we can see it and the manifestation of it and the principles laid down in this Elohistic being through the things that are made. And his eternal power, which is the power to transform, which he did into the creation, and his supernal nature, meaning he is Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua here, and he represents that by this heart that you see, which is universal spirit law. Now, if you notice in this plate here, there is no heart, because it was one man with the woman inside the man or hidden in the man. And once the sexes are separated, the only way that we can have unity is to be one unit. Do you understand? So it wasn't because Yahweh wasn't present. He now put the man as the one to look at, the principle that is living every day of the creation. You my forehead? Now, 1 John. Somebody. 5 and 7. King James Version.
1 John 5:7, King James Version. For there are three that bear record in heaven.
Mm-hmm.
The Father.
Uh-huh.
The Word.
Uh-huh.
And the Holy Spirit.
Uh-huh.
And these three are one.
Now, the Word or Son is really the same person. A little confusing when you think about it, but everyone thinks, oh, this is the Son. And they're right. Yeah. But for the principle of the supernal nature, it's the Holy Spirit. But hold that thought. When Yahshua the Messiah arrives on the earth, he is the son of the high El, but his mission or his job as the Messiah is to be the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. John talks about in 14:26, the Comforter who is the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and bring all things back into your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you or preached unto you, right? Now, that is manifested throughout the ages and dispensations with Adam, everyone in between Noah, and everyone in between to Melchizedek and Abraham, and everyone in between, until the Messiah takes up residence in a body as Yahshua himself, and then dies the death of an outcast dog. Now, it's, what is it, First Timothy 1:20, 1:19.
Faith and a good conscience.
No, Second Timothy.
Grant unto him that may find mercy.
No. Is it Thessalonians? Is it? Yes. Yeah. What is it?
3:16. 2 Timothy 3:16.
Mm-hmm.
All the scriptures that is given by the inspiration of Yahweh is profitable for doctrine, for reproof.
Nuh-uh. That's not what I'm looking for. Let me see the book. That one. I can't believe it. Man, I swear. It's not.
What are you looking for?
Peter. Knowing this verse.
Oh.
Peter, 2 Peter 1:20.
There you go.
Knowing this verse, that no prophecy of the scripture is of any private interpretation.
Read.
For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man.
So the prophecy or the scriptures didn't come by the will of man. But
holy men of Yahweh spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit.
So they were moved by Yahshua the Messiah, or Yahshua himself, as the Holy Spirit. Now, are we? We're still in 1 John, right? Read.
For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, and these three are one.
Uh-huh.
And there are three that bear witness in earth,
read,
the Spirit,
and
the water, and the blood,
read,
and these three agree in one.
Now, this goes back to Romans invalidating that scripture. This is an expansion of that thought about how everything that is made is a manifestation of Yahweh and himself, and it's proven by the supernal nature of Yahweh. So there are three that bear witness in the earth, the spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree in the one. They're not one, but you can't have one without the other. If you have a person without blood, they are no longer alive. If that same person has blood but has no water in their body, they are yet not alive. And if they do become dehydrated, there are fluids that need to be put back into their body just so they can be alive. I dare someone without a spirit try talking to me. Good luck. It just ain't happening. So we can't have one without the other, but yet they agree in one. Just like the union of the spirit, they are one. Meaning this, Yahweh, who is creator of everything that you see and that you don't see, isn't just a creation, it didn't just create it. He is that which he created, if that makes any sense. It's almost like you clear your mind and then you think of an object, whatever that object is. It just was concocted in your mind. You can see it, you can almost touch it, but it was already there, but not until you put it in your mind did it come to a conscious reality. That's how this creation is, right? And not only did he create it, then he got in it and operated through it. The same way that object in your mind, it won't have any animation or movement until you give it. Until you start making that object, let's just say it's an animal, a leopard, it doesn't move until you tell it, I want to see it move. I want to see it run. I want to see it attack something. I want to see it jump on a wall. It's not moving until you tell it to. Kind of like the way your mind doesn't move until you, till your brain tells it to. I mean, your body don't move until your brain tells it to. It's the same concept, right? And so thus it was. But it is Yahweh who takes up residence in his creation. And then you have the opportunity to see it and feel it. Because there are two different states of Yahweh. The incorporeal and the corporeal. Now, you can't have one without the other. Just like you have a physical body, but you have a spirit operating in it. Right. You can't have a physical body and without a spirit, and you can't have a spirit without a physical body unless you be dead. Right? So there are no such things as bodies walking around without spirit, because that don't make sense. And until you leave this plane, your spirit takes up residence in your body. Mm-hmm. And when it's not, it goes right back to where it originated, Yahweh himself. Mm-hmm. Now, where are we reading?
1 John 5 and 7. That's
what we're done, right?
Yes.
All right. Now give me, that's where I was going. Now give me John 1 and 1. Now, a lot of this we've talked about in the last, 3 weeks to a month. It's been a constant conversation that we've been discussing. And for me, the unity of the spirit is something that kind of gets lost in translation. At first, it seems very simple. But when you think about what it actually is, it's really just Yahweh who's here and here, but yet the same person, same being, in operation. But for the purpose of a principle, we have a word, which is the logos or beginning of all things. And then we have the Son, which has its own role in the gospel.
Right. Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
Now, when the word is in operation, it is creating, it is communicating, it is starting something. The Son is executing what was started. So Yahshua has his role as the Son, and Yahshua has his role as the Word.
Right.
It's always been the same. It's never not been Yahshua, and it meaning it has never not been Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Sounds confusing, but when you think about it, it's really just it's just Yahweh. Who's an author that writes a book as one person, but really their real name is something totally different? I can't think of one off the bat. Does anyone have one? Right. I don't remember the author's name, huh? The author that wrote Stuart Little wrote the story under this name, but really it was someone else. The ideas, the story came from this author. And the credit went to the name that was on the book. But it was all someone who originally made the story. That is no different than what Yahweh is doing. He has given the glory to Yahshua Messiah. That's why the book is all about Yahshua, his institution and fulfillment. That's all the book is. It makes you think that it's like a plot twist in the end. In the beginning, it seems like Yahweh is just mad at his own creation. I mean, he's setting laws, killing people, burning things up, destroying cattle, the whole nine yards. And then Yahshua comes on the scene. He's nice and peaceful, and he don't hurt nobody, turn the other cheek. It would give you the appearance as two different people. But that is just not so. According to a principle, it has to be that way.
Mm-hmm. E.B. White.
Huh? E.B. White. Right.
His real name is William Strunk Jr.
Nothing close to E.B. J.K. Rowling? Right. Oh, believe me, she came out when she... Oh, this book is popular? It's me, J.K. J.K., it's me. It's me. Give me that glory, right? That's the difference, right? That's funny. But that's how Yahweh is, right? It makes you think one thing and turns you a totally different way. Like, to this day, people think Jesus is coming back to save us. If he already did it here, why would he repeat the same thing again? Because people don't realize that Yahshua's mission was just to fulfill. It wasn't to set up a Christian way of living. It wasn't to teach us how to live a life of morality. He didn't teach us any of that. That's not what he was here for. He was here to get us to keep our eyes on the prize. You are saved by grace if you believe that I did what I said I did. Now, not only did I do it, but I left evidence to prove that I did all these things. If you can't find me, use the key that I gave you. It shows the unity of the Spirit, having one, two, three compartments. And then, if you don't understand it, at least look to yourself. I gave you all the things you need. You have a head, a chest, an abdominal region. You have nine systems to match my nine furnishings. I even gave you, the idea of pillars, boards, and bars to match the bones in your body. I put three different types of animal skin to show you that you have three layers of skin. I was giving you all the evidence the entire time, and you didn't even pay attention. I even taught you about your body through medical journals and the whole nine yards. We have a whole medical community that knows about the body. And listen, no one ever said that the gospel doesn't align with science. Christianity does. Other religions do, But we're here to tell you we like science. Science validates our claim. Yahweh said, be fruitful and multiply. And guess what? One atom became two, two became four, four became eight. And next thing you know, boom, we got a universe that is ever expanding. Y'all crazy. Right? So we don't have a problem with science. Science can't understand how vegetation came on the third day, but yet the sun came in on the fourth. But what they forget is, on the first day, he separated the what from the what. The light from the darkness. Right. So if there is light, what light was it talking about?
The word.
Well, let's read it. John 1:1.
In the beginning was the Word.
Read.
And the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh.
So the Word was with Yahweh. That looks like with. And the Word was Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh.
Now, this beginning is not talking about the beginning of Yahweh, because Yahweh has no beginning or ending, but he is talking about the beginning of beginnings for life itself, for creation itself. Read.
All things were made by him.
Mm-hmm.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Now let's explore this one thing that I just said. If we're talking about the creator of heaven and earth, everything you see and that you don't see, and everything that's being done in the realm of eternity. Someone, anybody, please let me know, how long has the realm of eternity been in existence? Can you quantify that? Right.
It's eternal.
Right. And what scientists will say, the earth could not be created in 6 solar days. I don't disagree with you. But we're not talking about the earth happening on its own. It is happening according to a purpose and plan that happened in the realm of eternity. There is no time. There is no clock that's, you know, eternity has been in existence for eternity. So the substance that is used to create a creation has aged. Not until time is put on it, then we can see the age within that substance. Does that make sense? So when scientists say, well, there's just no way. We have millions of years of data that tell us that this is stuff. Like I said, realm of eternity. There is no time. This happened in 6 solar days. And it says, when we get to the third chapter of Witchcraft, it shows that they were there for 40 days and 40 nights, but yet it was just one day. In the day that Yahweh created man.
Right.
But when you do according to the vision, it was 40 solar days in principle, right? But yet, one day until an act occurred, and then boom, time began. So if there is no calculation on time, just do the math on what that would look like for creation itself. Because before it was all of this, it was that. And remember, Yahweh had to slow this down for us in 6 solar days. So if it had to be slowed down just for 6 solar days so that we could see what time looked like, imagine what that would be like, just the amalgamation or conglomeration of according mass, right? Now you can read.
In him was life.
Uh-huh.
And the life was the light of men.
So in him was life. So just the existence of him is the light of man. So that means that would be the light that shineth, that gives light to all the world, right?
Right.
So he is that light. And you notice he's represented on every plate. Because that's Yahweh Elohim. And present and accounted for, according to the scriptures. Read.
And the light shineth in darkness, mm-hmm. and the darkness comprehended it not.
So it would make sense, based on that statement, that light shined out of darkness, illuminating the vegetation, and the darkness comprehended it not. Which son has a question? Hold your horses. Please don't make me look stupid. No, I'm just joking. Go ahead. What's your question?
So, was man the first being on earth?
No.
So who?
Who?
Who or what was?
The animal kingdom was here first.
Okay, because.
Why?
Because the way that I kind of saw it was that man was the first being on earth, the way that you kind of explained it, but. That made no sense, but
okay. Well, let me explain why. Animals were given life first and given territory within the creation. Man was created second for this reason. If we created the animals and we were the first ones here, we'd be like, yeah, we did this. Somebody would be like, yeah, I created this thing. Because that's what we do. We lie. We take credit for things we didn't do. I mean, if we could sell air, we would. Good thing we can't create it. But no, it was not man. It was animals. Where the heck was I?
Fifth verse.
Go ahead. Wait. So, if the word is the light that shined out of darkness and darkness comprehended it not, that's what provided light for the vegetation. Hence how we could have vegetation. Now, the sun comes in on the fourth day, pointing to the S-O-N, coming in on the 4,000 year, or the fourth millennium. And the principle of four is all throughout the scriptures. There's a four here at the door. There's a four here at this door. There's just a principle of four everywhere. They were here for 40 years, zero being a placeholder. The number four is what we need to focus in on. And it points to the Messiah. So, hence why we have this vegetation, because of Yahweh or the light. Meaning, what did he say? Where did Messiah say, I am the light? I can't think of it. Huh?
John 14.
Let's read it. Mm-mm.
Got it?
No.
What was it? I am the light. I always get it wrong.
I don't think it's 14.
John 8:12.
There you go.
John 8:12.
Mm-hmm.
Then spake Yahshua again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world.
Mm. So John talks about the word being the light, being life, and the light of men. And here's Yahshua the Messiah saying, I am the light of the world. Mm-hmm. Sound like the same person, right? Now, go back to John 1:1 and keep reading.
John 1:6.
Mm-hmm.
There was a man sent from Yahweh whose name was John.
Mm-hmm.
The same came for a witness to bear witness of the light,
mm-hmm.
that all men through him might believe.
Now, you have light, that light of every man that cometh into the world. So before the S-U-N came in, we had light bearing witness of the true light that lighteth every man in the world. Do you get me? Get the point? There's always got to be a herald. My dad would call this cosmic light that lighteth the world until the S-U-N was created or brought into existence physically so. Now notice how we have one that is cosmic or spiritually so, and then we have an actual physical light that is lighting creation. We can't have one without the other. This is Yahshua as the Word, providing the light that lighteth every man or everything in the world. And then we have Yahshua coming into the world, lighteth all of creation. Does that make sense? Do you see the principle there? Yes? Yeah. No? Maybe so? You look kind of confused? Okay, good. Moving on. Read.
8th verse. Mm-hmm. He was not that light.
Read.
But was sent to bear witness of that light. Mm. The true light was that which lighteth every man that cometh into the world.
Now, John on the Isle of Patmos is talking about John the Immerser or John the Baptist for a reason. Because everyone thought he was the Messiah. Mm-hmm. We don't have it pictorially illustrated, but there were a multitude, thousands of people out here waiting to get baptized. They're either waiting or witnessing what was happening. Because they all thought John was the one. But he was not so. And so John on the Isle of Patmos, John the Apostle, felt it was noteworthy to say, hey, John was created to bear witness of that light, but he was not that light. Because people actually thought he was. Even when they were here, when Peter sees this vision, he says, let's make one for John. Wait. Not, huh? Yeah. Moses. And he talks about Elijah. Mm-hmm. Right? Mm-hmm. Read.
He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not.
Read.
He came unto his own tribe, and his own people received him not.
Now, that's because he put a veil over their eyes so that they could not see him. It wouldn't be any good for them to see who that was and still be there to save him. They would not have killed him if they knew who that was. His job was to fulfill and die a death for all mankind. But if mankind knew that that was God in the body, they would not have killed him. So he rode in on a donkey, thinking he's just anybody else walking through the, coming into the, to the village. Because guess what? If he came in looking like Aladdin coming to Agrabah, they would all would have known, oh, we can't mess with him. Nobody gonna kill the King of Kings, right? Creator of heaven and earth. That don't make sense. But thus, he put a veil over their eyes. And listen, he didn't speak direct. He was very cryptic. Spoke in parables. Right. Mm-hmm. He was like Yoda before his time. You know what I mean? Speaking all crazy. Yeah, I have no idea what he's talking about. He say something to you, walk away like, that was pretty. What did he just say? Seriously. Nobody knew what the heck he was talking about. I'll tear this temple down, bring it up in 3 days. Yeah, right. You ain't going to knock this down. He ain't even talking about that. He's talking about this. Because they don't know the difference between this and that. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That was the Messiah. He was a trickster. But not because he didn't know. He did it for a purpose. He had to hide in plain sight. Yeah. Read.
But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the children of Yahweh.
Read.
That is to them that believe on the name of him.
Now, there were many messiahs out there. many false messiahs. I'm going to name a few. Maybe you've heard of them. Maybe you haven't. But I'm going to do the best I can. Zechariah, Habakkuk, Jonah, Obadiah, Daniel, Hosea, Ezekiel, Ezra, they've all been considered messiahs, but they weren't. They weren't. They had a role to play. They were important people for what they did, but they were not the messiah. They were there to bear witness or prophesy about the one that was to come. Right. But they weren't that. But they were considered false messiahs because they were perceived to be the one that's going to save every man. If you start reading all these scriptures about, it was kind of like this. Noah preached about a flood. Prior to Noah's time, it had never rained a drop. But he's talking about it's going to rain so hard, it's going to flood. Can you imagine? Year one, people are like, hey, Noah's trying to help us. He's going to get us ready. And so year one, he had a whole multitude of people helping get this ark built. Yeah, we you know, they was beating them things down, helping them out, working. But no flood. Year two, few people dropped off, but they, you know, faithful people. But can you imagine 120 years waiting for something to happen? By the time it was all said and done, he had no one but his family. Not a one. Because they ain't seen not a drop. Not a drop of water coming from the sky. And they said, man, you done bamboozled us to build you your own yacht. This was a old school Ponzi scheme. Give me all you can. Everybody come on. Give me some of that help. We're going to make this happen. And the only person with a big boat is Noah. Everybody else is without. Can you imagine? That's what it was like. And not until Yahweh closed the door. Trip, 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 trip. Can you imagine? Oh, man, we messed up. We forgot. We you know what? We believe you. Well, by then, he couldn't open the door. It was one of those doors that opened from, it only opened from the outside. Can you imagine? Mm-hmm. But that's what it was like. Everyone thought they knew. Everyone had faith until, oh, wait a second. People just gave up faith. They just lost hope. You've been reading about this guy coming, waiting, hoping, and wishing. You got taken over by everybody coming. Every army wanted to come through. Just, can you imagine? Just getting, Nebuchadnezzar comes in, destroys your whole civilization, enslaves you all. You ain't got no hope. Romans come in. Everybody's taken from the Israelites. And you just hoping and wishing for a savior that you've been reading about, praying to all your life, every generation. It was literally like Noah's Ark. But remember, history just keeps repeating itself. It never stops. It repeats itself because there's a pattern in operation. One, two, three, one, two, three. Oh, wait, looks just like this. One, two, three. It's all been happening. To this day, people rise, they fall, they rise, they fall, they rise, they fall, because this was a round trip. It didn't just, you don't just start here and get here and it's like, oh, I won. No. You fall again, go back up, you fall again, you go back up. That is all it is. That's life. It's cyclical. You meet someone new, whether it be friend, foe, lover, whatever. Everything seems all good in the beginning. Let's just take a couple. You meet each other. It's all you know, rose petals and unicorns in the beginning. Feels really good inside. You're like, woo, I love them, I love them, I love them. And then the reality sets in. Man, I don't like the way this dude be brushing his teeth. Man, she don't even push a chair in the dang on table. Do you know he don't even make the bed in the morning? She can't cook to save her life. We do this all the time. And after 10 years, we look back like, I'm moving on. Because we think something's better out there. Then we go get what we perceive as better, and we start this whole process all over again. Rarely do we stay together. I don't know why this is so. And listen, this is the only time where old school is probably the best school when it comes to marriage. Y'all think I'm making this up, don't you? I'm dead serious. And listen, I learned this from my stepmom, who was goo goo gaga with my dad. But she learned after that marriage, this is how it should be. Mm-hmm. So, and I only can validate this because I've spoken to a lot of married couples from way back when that stayed together for till they died, or till one died, or whatever the case may be. And they all said the same thing. She said, don't marry for love, Chris. Because if you do, it's doomed to fail. But if you marry because you guys align, your goals are in the same place, or the same direction, and you guys have, everything looks right, works right, you guys have the same goals, and listen, everything has to be on the same page. Love will follow. Case in point, my in-laws, they were high school sweethearts, but not really. He wanted to hook up with somebody else, but she said, you're better suited for me. And he goes, really? Because he was a blonde, good-looking dude way back when, surfer guy. He just liked drinking beer and hanging out with his friends. He didn't know any better. He was chasing tail, didn't realize the tail he wanted was the one that said, hey, I'm choosing you because this works. Mm-hmm. His parents left him to the house and go fend for himself. So she took it upon herself to just come over, make him breakfast every day, make sure he was ready to go. They go to school separately, come back home. She make him dinner, the whole nine yards. They weren't even dating yet. Mm. He wanted somebody else. But when it came time to being enlisted, because he got drafted, World War II. No, not World War II. Vietnam War. He was like, man, I need someone to take care of my place. And so he married her. Mm. They've been married ever since. It's been over 50 years. And guess what? Their lives aligned. He just wanted to have a family and take care of one. All she wanted to do was have kids. She didn't want to have a big flashy life, and neither did he. He was a country boy that liked to just hunt and fish and camp and do what people do simply. And she wanted the same thing. They weren't in love because I just told you, he wanted somebody else. And listen, I heard the story from both of them. They literally told them the same story in front of each other. And she said, I refused to let him go with her because you know what? I was better suited for him. Mm. And he goes, she's right. That girl, she just wasn't for me. So we chose each other. They weren't in love, and she was second choice. But to this day, they've been together ever since. They will die married to each other. Successful marriage. And listen, in front of everyone, she's the best thing since sliced bread. When we at the campsite or at, just drinking without the women around, ooh, the stories I hear. It ain't always rainbows and unicorns. That's right. In fact, it hardly ever is. But for the sake of what their goals were, they keep it together. They love each other and would not have it any other way. Now, I'm not saying that nothing happened in between. I don't speculate nor know. I don't even care. The point I'm making is love had nothing to do with their motivation for being married. Now, take how society is today. We marry for love. Oh, I just love him so much. Yeah, I guess I love her, right? That's what we do. Not realizing he got bad credit, don't like his mama. I mean, she don't like to keep a house. She don't really want to have kids. Because nobody has those conversations anymore. Next thing you know, they get married. Seems like really good. Put it like this. There's more emphasis on the wedding than the marriage. And next thing you know, crumbles. I literally can't make this up. Marriage is what, 52% now? Likely to happen, end in divorce. That's a huge percentage. Now, Yahweh, he loved the world, and he did give his only begotten son. But there are some conditions you're gonna have to do a few things. You're gonna have to align to stay in good graces. Does it almost sound about right? If you believe in me, you will have everlasting life. If you don't, good luck to you. Right? He keeps it simple. He keeps it simple. See, nobody wants to take the time to actually get to know folks and connect, find out what's really happening. We like the aesthetics of people, right? Ah, she looks good. That's the one for me. But on the inside, she is ugly. Or, man, he has a really nice job, makes a lot of money. But he treats his mama like crap. But we don't find that out until after the fact. Mm-hmm. Or we close our eyes to the red flags. We do it all the time.
Yeah.
And I say we as in me. Mm-hmm. We all do it. Ain't nobody perfect in this world when it comes to this. We're bad at this stuff because we focus on the wrong things. At the end of the day, the only focus we should have is that of Yahweh and his purpose, this gospel. If we are not focused on that and looking for the principles that are laid down, if we don't recognize the intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love and justice, foundation, power and strength in people, then we are never going to be able to recognize that in us. Mm-hmm. And if we can't see us in them, why are we even spending our time there? Because it feels good, because it sounds good, because we're used to it. Mm-hmm. It's what we do. We like to take the easy road. The easy road is easy. Mm-hmm. But it's fruitless. You don't believe me? Ask Satan. He saw that he was the prettiest and brightest star of them all. And guess what? He was. Yeah. We ain't gonna knock it. But when he thought he was more than Yahweh himself, that's when he got in trouble. It was easy to see all that glitz and glamour, but didn't take the time to realize that, hey, it wasn't about him. That's a hard road to travel. We as people think it's about us. We're living our lives for us. Do you realize if our society actually cared about the person next to them more than they cared about themselves, our society would be better? We would have more compassion and understanding. There'd be more love spread throughout the world. And guess what? We wouldn't have so much suffering because we would all empathize and sympathize with the person next to us that we would be picking each other up. Mm-hmm. But there's very little of that. We are taught as a people to just take care of us. And so we do that. I only care about me and mine. That's what happens to black culture. We are so fixed on taking care of us that we don't follow in other cultures that care about the whole.
That's right.
How is it possible that an immigrant family can come to our country, have nothing, and after sacrificing for the greater good, everyone comes out winning?
Right.
And by winning, meaning they have a house, they have cars, they have, you know, they're well-to-do. They're not living la vida loca, but you know what? They ain't broke. Yeah. I've seen it time and time again. I have an Asian family. Grew up with them. They lived in my neighborhood. At the time, houses were only $110,000. When I met them, there were three families living in a four-bedroom house. Mm. No, two families. I apologize. My best friend was Lyle. His cousin Klein went to school with me. These two families lived in the house together. Lyle's parents owned the house, but his cousin, or in his family, lived there too. They lived there for about 4 years until they were able to take the equity out of that house and give it to them, and they bought their own house.
That's right.
And now they both have homes. They both have nice jobs. They all have good cars. And listen, they did it for the next family that needed to do it. Mm-hmm. Black culture is not willing to do that. Mm-hmm. A lot of American culture is not willing to do that. Mm-hmm. That is what society should do as a whole, according to how these principles are laid down. It's about giving. Yahweh didn't need this for us. He didn't need to do it. It was about him. It was about giving to others so that they can have an appreciation for what was given to them. It ain't easy. It's hard to do, but it's worth it for the greater good. Anyhow, at the end of the day, Yahweh would have been nothing more than a blessing to me than anything. And every hard lesson I've had to learn over the years, and I've learned a lot of hard lessons, I've only benefited from my failures, then regretted them. And listen, I failed a lot. And I'm pretty sure everyone in this room has had a lot of failures, right? Mm-hmm. Failing is only good if you can learn from it. When failure becomes who you are because you just accepted the fact that you failed and you're not going to get any better, that's when you begin to die. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with failing if you are trying to grow from it. My dad used to tell a story about it all the time. He attempted his boards to be a PA 3 times before he passed. In his mind, he needed to learn something from each failure. He thought it was really prepared when he left. He literally finished school, studied for his boards, and then took them. He thought, for sure, I'm going to walk into this job. He had to give up the job because guess what? He wasn't prepared. He didn't pass his boards. And he didn't fail by a long shot. It was literally by, so he just knew the next time he's going to do it, he's going to pass, and he failed yet again. The look on his face for months was hard to look at. In fact, when he walked into a room, I scattered like roaches because bad things were about to happen. He was a bad mood. But that third time, he eliminated all distractions, me included. Because apparently I was a distraction. That's how I lived with my mom with that for 2 years. It was beautiful. Good times. But he went back, redid it, and then he passed. Because he needed to learn something from it. Mm-hmm. He actually got to learn what life was like without Chris. Boy, was that a bad idea. I came back home and life was rough. But anyhow, the point I'm making is we have things to learn from. We grow from failure. We don't stay there unless we choose to. There's nothing wrong with losing. As long as you're willing, it's nothing wrong with failing as long as you're willing to fail forward. If you can fail forward, meaning you're growing from your failures, then there's nothing wrong with that. But when you continue to let failure be who you are, then you become that. and you can't accept that. That's like accepting Satan as your Lord and Savior, meaning Jesus Christ. Good luck with that. Mm. Anyhow, I hope and trust you got something we're still on the floor today. Thank you very much for your time. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Dr. Williams. That will conclude today's class. We hold classes here at 1816 East Elma Court in Ontario, California on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 7:30 p.m. to 9:30 p.m. and on Sundays from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m. Any and all donations may be had by our treasurer, Dr. Eunice Reiser. Let us all stand to be dismissed with the doxology taken from the last two verses of the book of Jude. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy, to the only wise Elohim our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all time, now and ever. Let us all say, Hallelujah. Hallelujah.